Oh man, been a long time since an update. It's starting to pile up. A lot of doomy, sludgy, not so happy music to talk about. I do need a coffee though. I'll be right back. Disappointed the sad slide whistle doesn't sound as sad as it should IRL. What's up? Welcome back to Ground Zero Salem. I'm your host Pat. How you doing? How's your mental health? Mine's good. I haven't done an update in a while. Been feeling a little down, which is not really too uncommon, you know, like probably most people on the planet now. I got a little case of the old mild depression, nothing to be concerned about. Don't really feel actively sad most of the time. A friend of mine was talking about it on social media not that long ago. It's just I feel lazy, less motivated to do stuff like exercise or do hobbies, you know. Comes along with winter and the general state of things in the past year or so. Don't really need to bring up that elephant in the room yet anyway. So I've got a stack of stuff kind of thematically lined up around that. Whole lot of sludge, whole lot of doom, death, some kind of negative metallic hardcore 90s stuff, pre-swoopy hair eyeliner metalcore kind of stuff. And it's all stuff I've been listening to. Most of these are recent purchases, but there's some stuff that I've picked up, pulled out of the archives for it. Let me throw something on in the background here. Let's see here. Turn this up a little bit. I think I can play this a little bit louder. It sounds loud to me, but then I always play it back and can barely hear it, you know? Probably a setting on this new Blue Yeti microphone I can fix for that, but I don't know how to do anything. I'm a Luddite. This is Black Train Jack. Melodic hardcore band from New York City. They had two records, this first one here, No Reward, and then a second one called You're Not Alone. And the reason I'm throwing them on in the background is for a little contrast. You know, we're talking about really bummed out kind of music, and I figured it'd be nice to put something on relatively upbeat and positive sounding in the background. The other reason why is, unfortunately, a bad one. Rob Vitale, the vocalist, just passed away from COVID-19 about a week ago. And it hit me kind of hard. Like, people that I don't know, you know, people from bands and stuff like that, you know, it's a bummer, but it hit a little bit closer to home because this band was a big deal to me, like, my last year in high school or so when I was going through it with the depression stuff. And their records were a testament to the power of music affecting your mood positively if you listen to the right kind. You know, hardcore and punk in general kind of being inspirational. It was just a little recipe in the mix to help me along, sort of a coming of age era in my life. But they really were my gateway drug to stuff like 7 Seconds and Dag Nasty and that kind of melodic hardcore stuff, and just kind of the energy that provides. Stuff like that doesn't hit you the same way when you're 43 as when you're 17, but when you're a teenager and you find stuff like this, it, for me anyway, from my personal experiences, it really brightened my day. So RIP Rob Vitale, thank you for the help. So that being said, let's delve back into the dark recesses of several subgenres, all of which are slew. Got a new release to talk about first here. This is Demon Head. They are Danish. This is their, I believe, fourth or fifth album. This is on Metal Blade. It just came out this year. I had one of their earlier records, Thunder on the Fields. This isn't quite straight up like a doom metal release. It's more like 70s hard rock inspired kind of stuff. Pretty unique vocal approach. Certainly almost sounds more like almost like a Uriah Heep or like Thin Lizzy kind of influence rather than Black Sabbath. The guitars are cleaner. It has a certain mournful kind of like melodic vocal approach that's sort of croony. I really like their last record too that I have, the that Thunder on the Fields. I'm not sure of the chronology really off the top of my head, but this just came out. It's good. And then what kind of sparked this whole descent into a lot of sludge and doom and stuff, sludge and stoner doom, which are two genres I was previously very picky about. I love my traditional doom, epic doom kind of stuff, if you really want to split it into tiny subgenres. Grew up loving Candlemass and St. Vitus and all the big guys, all the heavy hitters. And a lot of these artists I'd given a shot to and kind of liked in passing, but for whatever reason, maybe the state of mind you're in or whatever, it just kind of clicked and I went nuts on a couple of shopping sprees checking this stuff out. The first artist, and I had this when it came out, and didn't get it at all at the time, was Buzz Oven from South Carolina. Soar. This originally came out on Roadrunner, also in 93 or 94, I think. This is a Metal Mind repress. Polish label. I hear different things about how some of their reissues aren't legit. I don't know if that's true or not. They always do a really nice job with these gold CDs. The CDs themselves sound great. I don't know if a lot of them do remastering or what. I remember this, the layout of this being pretty faithful to the original pressing. And what I like about this band and why they kind of stuck out to me in terms of like kind of doing a genre deep dive is that they do have that Sabbath-y slowness to them, sort of tortured, distortion-soaked thing, but where they kind of set apart from other bands in sludge, I guess, is their riffs are, they have some riffs that are pretty Sabbath-y, but there's also a lot of like Amphetamine Reptile noisiness and even like some kind of like the dirtier, more distorted, noisy side of grunge. And that tracks because I read an interview with the chief songwriter from these guys and he's talking about being really into Nirvana, Bleach and stuff like that. It almost seems like it has just as much in common with like, I don't know, super early Helmet or something like that. I'm trying to think who else. Big Black, I don't know. I don't listen to a ton of stuff like that, but I've heard enough of it in passing where it doesn't sound like a purely metal influence kind of thing. There's some noisy rock thrown in there as well. So this is the one album they did on Roadrunner. They didn't last long. From what I read, drug use was one of the reasons they were ousted from the label. Again, hearsay and conjecture. Was supposed to see these guys with Guar and Bile, and they did not show up. But like I Hate God and a lot of other sludge bands, they had some releases on punk labels before they got onto a big metal major, because I feel like sludge is one of those things where like it didn't really have a home when it started. Sludge and Heavy Doom, I didn't pick it out to show it, just because I just got it like yesterday, but I got the Burning Witch discography double CD on Southern Lord there, and that that a lot of that material came out on Slap-A-Ham, you know, so interesting how that kind of, these bands kind of ended up on labels with really fast bands and stuff. So this is pretty much a sampling of all the other Buzz Oven releases over the years. A couple of the same songs, a bunch of stuff on this Buzz Oven record on Soar was on a previous EP, so songs from that EP also on this are on this. That's not confusing, right? And on this, some of the later recordings, past Soar, do get a little bit more like, hey, this is a reworked Black Sabbath riff. Here you go. You know, a little closer to I Hate God. But all of it is very fucking good. Speaking of I Hate God, probably longtime watchers of the channel will want to smack me, because I've gone back in on I Hate God. I know on a prior update from like 2 years ago or perhaps even further back, I believe I said, like, I just need one I Hate God record. You know, they all sound the same to me. And there's a very similar sound, but I just picked up Dope Sick, and I did have this dub of this when it came out. But I think on LP I have Take As Needed for Pain, and I really like that record. This is probably my favorite. And I just, I marvel at how much Jimmy Bauer can do with just backwards engineering, mostly Master of Reality riffs. They all kind of sound like you know, Master of Reality, maybe a few other Sabbath records, but specifically that Sabbath record to my ears, all twisted up with a lot of, like, ugly fucking feedback and just screeching kind of dirtbag tortured vocals from Mike. It's a masterpiece. But, you know, for the longest time, I wasn't in the mood for this kind of stuff. I was exposed to it extensively, you know, in the late 90s when the stuff started blowing up. There's a period during my scene's existence where I grew up, where people started to get more and more into sludge. A lot of people traded in their basketball jerseys for, you know, leather wristbands and stuff. Around the turn of the century, people started really getting into Down and Corrosion of Conformity. And I feel like I Hate God wasn't too far behind as far as the NOLA stuff, but they had that abrasiveness that just was not as accessible than the other bands from New Orleans. I always liked Crowbar, but I feel like Crowbar has a different kind of thing going on, with like a harder, tough guy kind of influence and stuff like that. So they're always different for me. I always worship that self-titled Crowbar record. Then we got Electric Wizard, Dope Throne. Another one. I had a ton of Electric Wizard stuff on vinyl over 10 years ago, and I liked it, but at that stage in my life, I wasn't holding on to stuff that I wasn't listening to constantly. So I ditched a bunch of it. I had the self-titled. I had We Live. I think I had one or two other ones. I think I had Come My Fanatics. And, like, for whatever reason, I went through a thing where I'm like, I'm gonna flip these. And Dope Throne, I actually never owned, but I had MP3s of, and I listened to a lot. But I think I needed to be in the proper headspace that I'm in now to, like, sit through stuff that's this gristly and blown out, and with some pretty lengthy compositions, those affected vocals. It's definitely Through a Haze and fucking rad. It's tough. I really do like Dope Throne. Several people I've talked to are like, yeah, Dope Throne's great. Everybody says that's the go-to one, but, you know, Come My Fanatics is the real all-star one. They're pretty much tied. I mean, I haven't spent that much time with these, like, this time around anyway, so I like them about equally. This is their third, this is their fourth? Maybe this is their second, this is their third? I don't remember. So they're still a pretty young band at this point. You know, this came out in 2000. This must have come out in 98 or 99, I'm guessing. I think early on, getting into Electric Wizard, it was a little tough for me because I was such a big fan of pretty much exclusively the first Cathedral full-length and Soul Sacrifice, and I just wanted so bad for this stuff to sound like Cathedral, and it's on the guy from Cathedral's label. Sounds nothing like Cathedral, you know. Way more psychedelic, way more experimental and noisy. But yeah, awesome. Then some kind of doomy death stuff here, just kind of like checking off boxes of bands that I never really got into back in the day. A few years ago, I finally really gave Anathema a good shot and was like, oh yeah, this is good, this is brilliant. Didn't like it when I first heard it as a kid. The Gathering, I can't remember if I heard this back in the day or not. I mean, I knew it was one of those early Peaceful bands that had a very doom death beginning and then went way into left field sound-wise, and I don't even know how. I don't know what their recent stuff sounds like, or their stuff when their sound changed. I don't know. I just wanted to hear the Doom Death stuff to start, anyway. This is Always. Band was from Holland. Whoa. This came out in 92, and then was remixed in 94. This has two CDs there. The original and the remix. And it's cool. I can definitely see how they were heavily influenced by Paradise Lost, and some other kind of like slower death metal influences. There's a lot of like, I don't know if it's a Korg or a Moog, but it sounds like an antiquated synthesizer used for a lot of atmospheric parts on it that I like a lot. Gaia's Dream is a jam, you know. There's like a certain like heavenly vocal kind of thing going on with that that I really like. I mean, it's never gonna be the same, hit me the same way like the first time I heard My Dying Bride or Paradise Lost Gothic, but it is really, really good. And then in a similar vein, excuse me, Catatonia, Dance of the December Souls, the first, I think, Catatonia record. I saw that Ben is talking about this on his latest update, but I didn't want to watch it yet because I didn't want to, you know, via osmosis, like, echo a bunch of stuff. I'm sure he has a more informed opinion about this than I do. But, yeah, for me, this is, like, it seems like they're taking a lot of the aforementioned influences of, like, that early Doom Death stuff, the European, British stuff, and really, like, really tuning it up for, like, maximum impact, you know? Like, it's a very dense batch of jams, lots and lots of, like, really hooky parts, super miserable, like, almost gothic in a way. It's weird, because I want to say that it sound like it hits the same way that Fields of the Nephilim and Sisters of Mercy hits without sounding anything remotely like it. It's like conjuring up the same kind of emotions, if that makes any sense, if that's not too, like, crystal sniffing for you. But yeah, just really pretty sounding Doom Death that's, like, miserable, but also just, like, very impressive. And then switching gears over to some stuff that's a little bit between sludgy stuff and hardcore, kind of exploring that gap. I mean, all these kind of power violence-y labels that help put the stuff out. I know that Slap-A-Ham did the Gasp full length, and I already talked about this very recently, actually, but I thought I'd bring it up again, just because I threw this back into the listening pile because I've been in the mood for this stuff. This was reissued by Dark Descent and Dark Symphonies, which is interesting. But yeah, a good combination of, like, crushing, plotting, sludgy elements and just enough, like, quick-wristed, very, very fast power violence or crust kind of stuff going on from Cali. And then in a similar vein, sort of, you have Face Down and Shit from North Carolina. This is a compilation of their early material called Shit Bloody Shit. Very nice. On Crimes Against Humanity Records. And then you have Nippon on Relapse. This came out in 2006. This is rad. I mean, the intro, the first song, Cinders, leads you to believe it's almost going to sound like almost like something like Catatonia. It's very, like, grandiose and keyboards and atmosphere and everything, and then it goes into, like, almost, like, straight up gnarly, like, motorpunk crusty kind of stuff, but they bust into all these great kind of sludgy grooves all over it, and towards the end it gets slower and slower. And then you've got this full length, which is just pretty much just a sludge record. There's a few fast moments briefly, but we're talking 7 songs over 40 minutes, and it stands out well enough. You know, again, they're not completely just stealing 70s rock riffs or anything like that. There's other stuff going into it. Pretty glacial, crushing, very good. Then we've got these guys, Shoot the Hostages. Maybe one of the lesser known bands that I'm going to talk about. This is No Witnesses CD that came out on Rodent Popsicle Records mid-late 90s, I think. These guys morphed into a band called Crash and Burn that were more of like a bar rock sort of, like, Zeke sort of thing, not as fast. These guys were great, sludgy, tortured punk, almost like if you took, like, Poison Idea and made it sludge somehow. It's the best way I can put it with this. It's really, really awesome. Like, a lot of straightforward punk riffing, but just slowed down and super just fucking wretched sounding. Awesome, awesome record. El Dopa. This is kind of a missing link band for me. I'd seen the name on flyers and, you know, heard of them a bunch. I knew that they were, like, part of that whole Oakland scene, Bay Area stuff related to Filth and Grimple and all these cool crust bands from the 90s. I believe this is the same artist that did the Grimple Logical Nonsense split there. And they have a lot of that sound, just that you know, rotting trachea, sort of Jake Filth kind of thing, that kind of vocal approach, but there's tons of lumbering sludge and heavy parts thrown in there, and plenty of fast, too. Just a fucking cool band. I even went to the trouble of buying the full-length discography from them. This is just the album, 1332, on East Bay Menace. Again, sometime in the 90s. Didn't research it. There's a compilation that has everything they did. A couple of demos, 7-inch radio set, the 1332 LP on TP Records, and it's pretty accessible. I got my copy for like $4 at Armageddon yesterday, so check it out. I'll leave links for everything, you know, it should go without saying. This isn't so much really sludgy. I mean, there are some tortured slow parts. The Scam, Sick World, New Hampshire band, late 80s, early 90s, I think. Everything they did, local label reissued all this stuff, Welfare Records. But what really strikes me about this is the vocal approach, and how nobody really talked about this guy's vocals, Eric. Okay, yeah, 85 to 90, and a lot of the music, too, seems ahead of its time. The vocals are very comparable to, like, Charles Maggio from Rorschach, the guy from Die Kreuzen, just really, I mean, punk vocals, but almost completely inhuman-sounding punk vocals. A lot of, like, weird kind of twists and turns, abrupt left, right, and up, down turns with the riffs on this. It's definitely a weird approach to songwriting, and I never really heard about these guys very much until I discovered them on a blog, when everything was on blogs 10 or 15 years ago. Even, like, moving to Boston in the late 90s, I'd never heard about them, you know, and they're a New England band. His Hero Is Gone, I figure it's worth a mention just because their stuff is so gloomy and crushing. Granted, this is a compilation of a lot of the stuff they did right before they morphed into tragedy. And you can hear that. It's happening, you know. There's not so much of the songs like Weeds on this. There's a lot more, like, straight-ahead charging, sort of almost Motorhead Discharge-inspired rhythms on this. But there's still plenty of crushing moments on this. Gloomy crust punk from the late 90s. If you know hardcore, you know His Hero Is Gone. Another one that's, like, kind of an obvious one, but I was like, you know, I need to revisit them, because for the longest time, I was like, Dystopia, man, I don't know, I don't think it holds up, but I never really went back and listened to it. A band that was around during the 90s that I listened to ad nauseum. You know, I had that one friend that played Dystopia all the time, and that might be why I had, like, an unfavorable memory of them. Also, like, cool band that does the drummer singing thing, but there are a few songs where Dino, the drummer, I just remember the vocals being almost kind of silly, like tortured yells screaming, you know. There's always the song about, I can't remember the name of it, the song about where he's talking about how he's not making enough money and he screams, "I need a raise, man." And it's like, I remember it being, I don't think that ages so well. And to be honest, like, it doesn't, but a lot of their stuff is really good. I rebought both of their records, The Aftermath and Human Equals Garbage. Both reissued on Tank Crimes. They originally came out on Life is Abuse, I think, which was the drummer-singer guy's imprint. And it's great. It's real melty-sounding, sludgy crust. Very well executed. Like, the players are fantastic on it. And it just, there's a certain effect on the guitar and the bass. I think it's a flange or something like that, where it just sounds like a very heavy psychedelic nightmare. And other than a couple of tracks that, like I said, feel kind of silly, a lot of it is an excellent critique of just modern life and just trying to get by, you know, starving. It's great. Dystopia. Then, Seized. So Seized were from Montreal, and they did a split with another band from Montreal called Ire. And in the midst of all this deep diving, I was like, oh yeah, fucking Seized and Ire, man. This band has two bassists, a la Man is the Bastard, No Means No, that kind of stuff. One bass playing more like a guitar and the other one playing more like a bass. Very fucking heavy, almost like death metal growly approach. Yeah, very fucking dark, punishing stuff. Then I got the couple of Ire CDs. There's one in the middle of this that I don't have. They have three releases. This is Adversity Into Triumph, which compiles their first 7-inch and the split with Seized, and I think a few other tracks. Ire sound a lot like one of my favorite bands of this style, this kind of like early metalcore style. They sound, to me, a lot like Acme, which is sort of like, again, that crazy larynx falling out like Charles Maggio from Rorschach kind of approach. I think Jake Bannon from Converge is another person that kind of embodies that style. I don't like his particular take on it, but that's my own taste. But these sort of like pained, screechy kind of vocals, a lot of like reverse engineered, reimagined kind of Slayer riffs, but at a, like a real punishing, you know, slow to mid-pace sort of march through a lot of it. It's super heavy. This, they get a little bit more sludgy. This is What Seed, What Root, that came out on Crimethink a few years later. All this stuff was like mid to late 90s stuff. And this, they actually kind of start to explore some kind of sludgy grooves, some almost touching upon like Sabbath-y kind of stuff. And it's great. These guys shared members with another band, or I believe transformed into another band, actually, come to think of it, called The Black Hand, that did a full-length and a 10-inch. And that band was really cool. They were the opposite. They were super fast. The beginning of sort of, like, invoking a lot of Slaughter of the Soul and Slayer, but, like, from a really, like, violent, angry kind of way of attacking it. It wasn't very slick, like a lot of bands would do later. You know, example of, like, early metalcore stuff. That band, Black Hand, that 10-inch, I love. They did a full-length with... the cover art was by Away from Voivod, and I had high hopes for that. Didn't like it so much, but Black Hand were good, too. Then we're going to take a trip down to Florida for Drag Body. I'm pretty sure Drag Body were from Florida. They might have been from Atlanta. They thanked a lot of Atlanta bands on this, I noticed, but I'll correct it with a caption or whatever. I saw these guys a bunch of times in the late 90s back home. One of the guys who ended up booking Hellfest, the U.S. Hellfest, booked these guys pretty often. And, you know, this was the era of Botch and Dead Guy and Coalesce and the beginning of Converge and all that. And this falls neatly within those styles, you know, off-tempo rhythms, a lot of kind of like jagged riffs and stuff like that. I'd say, unlike Coalesce or Dead Guy, there's a lot more kind of shreddy metal riffing thrown in there. Yeah, a lot of just mid-paced kind of stuff. Vocalist losing his shit. Sounds like he's having a nervous breakdown. Definitely loved this band live, and I was like, fuck, man, Drag Body ruled. And the thing about this style of stuff, you know, on CD, hardcore fans aren't really like metal fans. Like, nobody really wants CDs right now, so all this stuff was pretty cheap, and I wanted to own it. So, Drag Body's great. Another band that I have a lot of fond memories of seeing, because my band played with them once, and they played Syracuse a fair amount early on, is this band from Philly, All Else Failed. This is their first album, A Most Bitter Season. And this is a compilation of 7-inches and demos, odds and ends comp, called Good Enough for the Girls We Roll With. Good title. These guys were really heavy. They had that discordant, kind of chaotic approach. Weren't too metal, not too dissimilar to Dead Guy and Coalesce, I guess. There was a lot of the rhythmic approach that were like, like these kind of like almost tribal, or the like dot 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 dot, you know, kind of random, almost seemingly random, like weird patterns with the drum approach. And for a while they had two singers. The first time I saw them, they played to, I think, like 20 people at the community center in my hometown. My band opened, and it was like some very like clean cut looking, you know, jockey hardcore dudes losing their fucking minds, like just freaking out and like accidentally and intentionally hitting each other. I think two singers like doing leapfrog, like jumping off of each other's backs. It was one of the more nuts things that I've seen, and they were playing to like 20 people. I've noticed that like as they went on, past, because I have their first 7-inch, which is included on here, they had a few things going for them that were like pretty unique compared to a lot of the like chaotic metalcore or whatever you want to call it from the time. For one thing, they had a bassist that was really accomplished and could kind of carry things in somber moments when things died down and got a little bit more mellow in the songwriting. That almost took it in like a weird proggy direction. They had one guy who was yelling, and then another guy who is kind of like mournfully singing, and I can't really describe it. It's not a metal vocal approach, but it's not like, it's not like anything that came after in metalcore with that like whiny clean, you know, kind of thing either. He definitely, like, everybody just sounded upset in this band, and it's really hard to fake that, like, especially to me. I've seen lots of performative anger and, ooh, look at me, I'm crazy, you know, type of shit with a lot of hardcore bands and metal bands, and like, these guys weren't fucking around. It was very convincing approach. It was, I'm sure, some sort of cathartic release for them. Great band. And also, like, a little bit later on some of this, there are those proggy elements, but there's also, like, some other stuff going on with the instrumentation that's, like, pretty interesting. I think some synthy parts and some weirdness. It's very cool. Then we got Neglect from Long Island. This is 4 years of hate. This is a bunch of, like, demo recordings, some Don Fury stuff, some live stuff. It's a 2-CD. Neglect are just, like, hatecore personified. Just negative, pissed off New York hardcore. They make Sheer Terror sound like, I don't know, Lifetime, you know? Just pissed. A lot of it's, like, that kind of, like, jump the fuck up kind of rhythm, like, Biohazard-ish breakdown, like, that kind of stuff as far as rhythmically. But they do get some, like, circle pit-inducing fast parts here and there. Certainly if you like Sheer Terror or anything along those lines, and you haven't checked out Neglect, it's something to check out. There's a song on it that just called Fuck Life. Like, there's a song called Dig It about, you know, your grave, horror-struck, fucking, yeah, just very, very fucking pissed, very negative. And then finally, this is not, doesn't really quite fit in with everything conveniently, but this isn't about a genre study anyway, it's about my feelings. We got both the Skin Chamber albums, Wound and Trial, reissued on Metal Mind, originally put out by Roadrunner. Definitely sludgy elements, really pained and slow, but metal industrial. Pretty impressive. Guys from Control Bleeding, a fairly popular industrial band at the time, wanted to do something metal. Actually, it's funny, in the booklet, they acknowledge it. They're like, yeah, Godflesh beat us to it, of course, but we still want to throw our hat in the ring. And they did a good job, because it doesn't sound anything like Godflesh. It's more resembling, I think, like a death metal take on... I want to say a death metal take on Early Swans. That's kind of what Godflesh is, but I don't know, approaching it from a different angle, particularly with a really, like, corrosive bass tone on it. And they do a lot of slow punishing stuff, but there's also a fair amount of variety rhythmically, playing faster and stuff, and great, like, I don't know, like, just corrosive, like, almost sort of, like, John Tardy school of death metal vocal, kinda. It sounds like it's going down a drain. Fucking great. Cool band, nobody ever talks about them. They were, like, the odd man out on the At Death's Door comp. That was the first time I heard them. At Death's Door 2, with the song Sucked Inside, which is probably their best jam. James, their best jam. All right, so we'll see. I should be back sooner than later. Who knows? It's my channel. I'll do what I want. That's about it. Once again, RIP Rob. Makes me so happy.